Topping the New York Times bestseller list.
The Shack is in the top 40 bestsellers of all history.
Having sold millions of copies since its release in 2007, the novel The Shack has become a publishing phenomenon. Now a feature film based on the influential book is to be released in March of 2017. What theology does the book teach? Should faithful Christians be concerned at its impact on the church? Documentary filmmaker Paul Flynn of Megiddo Films has released his latest work, The Shack, Its Dangerous Theology and Error, in an attempt to answer these questions. To watch this film free of charge, please visit our website at megiddofilms.org. That's megiddofilms.org.
You're listening to Megiddo Radio. Megiddo Radio is a radio ministry of Megiddo Media. For more, visit our website at megiddoradio.com. That's megiddoradio.com.
Hey everybody, welcome. This is Paul Flynn with Megiddo Radio for the 10th of September, 2016. Thank you all for tuning in. On this Saturday's show, we're going to be talking about Mother Teresa, as she is known. Now, I think everybody has heard of Mother Teresa, because due to the news there on the 4th of September last, this last Sunday, she was canonized by the Roman Catholic Church. Now, for those who do not know, canonization means that she is seen as a saint. Now, Rome's view on what a saint is can get a little bit confusing, but we'll go into that in a while. But I want to start off with the question, is Mother Teresa a saint? Now, where do we start? I particularly am doing this show with the prayer that dear Roman Catholics who are listening to this, may be listening to this, would search the scriptures, like the Bereans in Acts 17:11, and see if these things be so. What is a saint according to the word of God? Now, Rome fights against sola scriptura, which means the Bible is the final authority. Now, there's often Roman Catholic apologists often have straw men versions of sola scriptura, but sola scriptura means that the Bible is sufficient. It is the final authority. It is not the only authority. There is an authority in the church, but this comes from the word of God. This is our foundation. This is from which we get all of our theology. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. That passage of scripture, 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 16 and 17, lays out that scripture is sufficient for everything the believer needs to live the Christian life. We cannot claim that infallible standard for anything else. No human authority, no decree from a council. If a council is to be obeyed, it must be in accordance with the word of God. Nothing else. If it is a worship added outside of the word of God, not envisaged in the word of God, it is a violation of the second commandment, where we use our imaginations to come before the holy and true God, because he has instituted how he is to be worshipped according to his revealed will. And he is to be worshipped, him and him alone. That is the first commandment. Now, obviously, Mother Teresa has much of the media on her side. Not everybody was a fan. I'm not necessarily going to get into the people who agreed with her, the people who didn't agree with her. This is not the purpose necessarily of why I'm doing this, but I want to ask the question, according to the Word of God, what is a saint? And saint is simply this. It is simply a Christian. In Romans chapter 1, verse 7, for example, it's Paul writes to the Romans, to all that be in Rome, beloved of God, called to be saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. It says, called to be saints. Now, I know before people will bring up, yes, there is a sense in which the Roman Catholic Church does talk about the saints as being all the faithful, as they would put it. I can't remember the exact paragraph, but it's in the Catechism. It does talk about it in two different senses. However, you never, ever hear about the sense in which all believing Christians, those who truly believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, are saints. The just shall live by faith. It talks about it again. You can go to many, many different passages. Philippians chapter 1, verses 5-7 reads, skipping past here. Okay. So, chapter 1, verses 5 to 7 reads, for your fellowship in the gospel from the first day until now, being confident of this very thing, that he which hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. Even as it is meet for me to think this of you all, because I have in my heart, inasmuch as both of in my bonds and defense, of the gospel, ye are partakers of my grace. Now, the point I want to point out here is, Scripture sees all believers as saints, does it not? But the Roman Catholic Church teaches that a saint, or a believer at one point, somebody who was a believer at one point, can fall away. But the Bible clearly states in different parts, in John chapter 10, but especially here, if Christ has begun a good work in you, he will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. This is not something you can apostatize from. If you apostatize from the faith, and it does talk about this in the Scriptures, these are people who are never born again. Jesus will say to them, depart from me, I never knew you. You that work iniquity. It says, Matthew chapter 7. Verse 21. Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father, which is in heaven. It's not because of him doing the will. It's because the person being regenerated, and that is the fruit of their life. Verse 22. Many will say unto me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name, and in thy name cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works? And what will Christ say to them? And it says, and then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. Or another way of saying that is, depart from me, those who lived as if I never gave you a law to obey. Hebrews chapter 6, verse 10. And the Bible talks many times about saints. It doesn't talk about praying to saints, but when it talks about the saints, it talks about those who are simply Christians. Verse 10, for it is not unrighteousness For God is not unrighteous to forget your work and labor of love that ye have showed toward his name, in that ye have ministered to the saints and do minister. Also, Jude 3, there's only one chapter in Jude, and it says, "Beloved, when I gave all diligence to write unto you of the common salvation, it was needful for me to write unto you and exhort you that you should earnestly contend for the faith once delivered unto the saints." And I know, again, I realize, and I was going through the catechism, that yes, Rome does mention this at time to time, but then they talk about in a special sense, there's these people who are recognized as having performed some very heroic duties in their life. I'll just go to paragraph 828 of the Catechism of the Catholic Church. And the Catechism of the Catholic Church is not, when it's being referenced, it should be referenced in paragraphs, not page number. I think probably because a lot of people have different page numbers and things like that, and it's a lot easier to find it. Paragraph 828 says, "By canonizing some of the faithful, i.e. by solemnly proclaiming that they practice heroic virtue and lived in fidelity to God's grace," now that's a problem right there. None of us have been completely faithful to God's grace. God's, we're saved by grace because of Christ, what Christ has achieved. Our faith is weak. It's a gift of God, lest any man should boast. Ephesians 2, verses 8 to 10. But if we're depending ourselves on our faith in God, we're in trouble because it's not an infallible ground. We must rest and trust, not in our faith, but in Christ. There's a difference, you see. One, we have confidence because we have maintained, if you're in the Roman Catholic Church system, you have confidence. Actually, you're not allowed to have confidence. It's seen a presumption. But because you have continued in the sacraments, you're basically, your trust in that system. Now, friends, listen to me. I grew up a Roman Catholic, for those who do not know this. I departed from the faith many years, and it was later when I came to Christ that I began to compare the scriptures. When God regenerated my heart, gave me a new nature, I compared the scriptures with what the church, the Roman Catholic Church, taught, and it was completely different. But it talks about, right, the paragraph says, fidelity to God's grace. The church recognizes this as the power of the spirit of holiness within her and sustains the hope of believers by proposing the saints to them as models and intercessors. So as soon as somebody's canonized, they're held up. Here is a model that someone is to follow. And also their intercessors. Pray to them. There's nothing like that in the Bible. Well, there is in some ways. We are not to pray to anyone but God alone. Our prayers, that sweet smelling savor, in the same way the priest was supposed to offer incense, which is a picture of prayer, that is supposed to be offered to God alone through the only mediator, Jesus Christ. Now, I know the argument of, oh, well, the faith, you know, the faithful, the saints are so close to Christ that it still works in the same way. That is nonsense. It is only through the Son, Jesus Christ, we are to approach unto the Father. We are not to pray to anyone else, not Mary, not the saints, not anyone else. This is idolatry. It is a violation of the first and the second commandments. It's using the Lord's name in vain. The third commandment. Deuteronomy 18:11. We are not to pray to the dead. We're not supposed to speak to the dead. And I see this kind of stuff creeping into modern day evangelicalism. I remember, what was the name of the movie? I think it was Courageous. And a couple of years ago on the radio program, I was talking about Sherwood Pictures, how they had joined with Roman Catholic advisors, PR Maximus, I think they were called. It was a PR company, of what would be good for the Roman Catholic audience. And in Courageous, there was even a Roman Catholic actor. There was a couple of other things as well. But in the movie, the long and the short of it, one of the Kendrick brothers, can't remember his first name, is the director, one's the actor, but the guy who's the actor, was basically talking. Now, a lot of people do this. Now, it's not biblical. It's not biblical. We are not to pray to the dead. We are not to pray to our lost relatives. We're to pray to God alone. If our relatives or whoever our loved one is, regardless of who it is, be it a child, a wife, husband, whatever else, they will either go to heaven because they've been trusting in Jesus Christ, their sins have been washed away by the blood of the Lamb, they've been regenerated, new heart, and those whom he hath called, he also justified, and those who justified, he also glorified, so they will go off into heaven. But if they are not, if they have not trusted in the Lord Jesus Christ, and they're trusting in their filthy rags, then they will spend an eternity in hell. There's no purgatory spoken of in the scriptures. Deuteronomy 18:11. I'll read from 10 to 12 for context. There shall not be found among you any that maketh his son or his daughter to pass through the fire, or that maketh divination, or an observer of times, or an enchanter, or a witch, or a charmer, or a consulter with familiar spirits, or a wizard, or a necromancer. A necromancer comes from the word necro, means dead. Mancers, like, to communicate. To communicate with the dead is necromancy. Now, you probably say, what has this got to do with Mother Teresa? All that people have said for the last couple of days of Mother Teresa, pray for us. You're not supposed to communicate with the dead. And just to get back to the point, I never actually finished it. In that Courageous movie, there was, I can't remember the exact scene, but there was examples of necromancy. And it looks cute and innocent. But the guy was speaking at the grave and I think he was reading out a letter and he said, I forgive you. Now, I'm sure many people have done that, not realizing what they have done. But it is communicating with the dead. That's what it means. We're not supposed to do that. For all, it says in Deuteronomy 18:12, that do these things are an abomination unto the Lord. And because of these abominations, the Lord thy God doth drive them out from before thee. These things are, we're not supposed to pray to the dead. There's no mention of praying to saints. There's only prayers to God. Let's look again at the Catholic Catechism. Just to lay the foundation. That we realize, even if Mother Teresa was a godly Christian, we are not to offer our prayers to her. Otherwise, we are guilty of necromancy. In paragraph 2683 of the Catholic Catechism, states, and I'm not going to quote all of this, but it talks about the witnesses who have preceded us in the kingdom, especially those in the The church recognizes the saints share in the living tradition of prayer by the example of their lives, the transmission of their writings and their prayer today. They contemplate with God, praise Him, and constantly care for those they have left on earth. When they enter into the joy of their master, they were, quote, put in charge of many things, unquote. Their intercession, so about the Roman Catholic view of saints in heaven, their intercession is most exalted since to God's plan. Service, sorry, to God's plan. We can and we should ask them to intercede for us and for the world. Again, it is challenging Christ as the only mediator. And it also does this with Mary. We're not to pray to Mary either. I'll just look at one more Catholic Catechism paragraph. 2030 states, so this is from, okay, this is paragraph 2030. It states, for the church, I'm skipping the first half of it in case you're trying to follow it here. For the church, he learns the example of holiness and recognizes its model and source in the holy, in the all-holy Virgin Mary. He discerns it in the authentic witness of those who live it. He discovers it in the spiritual tradition and long history of the saints who have gone before him, who have liturgical celebrates the rhythms of... So it talks about this, says, quote, the spiritual tradition and long history of the saints. This is what he is supposed to follow. So I'm going to get back into this part, the theological part, in a second about what Roman Catholicism teaches, and many... Dear Roman Catholics are not aware of this. This is why I'm going through this, and I pray by the grace of God that this can be a blessing to you. And if you do not know Jesus Christ, to fall to your knees, to repent of your sins. Realize that we are all sinners. We have all fallen short of the glory of God, and we need a Savior. If we do not see ourselves as sinners, we have no hope. Christ came not to save the righteous. None of us are righteous. No, not one. But came to save sinners. So we'll go through some quotes from Mother Teresa's life. She has been seen as a wonderful example. I am not going to necessarily talk about her service. I'm going to give, for the purpose of this show, I'm going to give her the benefit of the doubt in order to cut it down as well, of what went on, that she helped the poor. Of course, there are people who challenge that, and I'm not dismissing those charges as things that people shouldn't investigate, but for the case of this study, I'm going to take for granted that she did many, many wonderful works. But the thing about it is she a saint? Truly a saint, in line with the Bible? Does she have what we would look for a member of the visible church, a credible profession of faith? For example, Judas had a credible profession of faith. He looked from the outside as if he believed in the true God, that he trusted in Christ. But Judas didn't. So we can't infallibly know if somebody's converted or not. Let's get that straw man out of the way. Yes, we cannot know somebody's heart. However, if somebody's truly converted, they will at minimum have is a credible profession of faith. If somebody is an atheist, then they're obviously not a Christian. If somebody is blaspheming God and hates the truth, hates the light, we can't just say, well, we don't know their heart. They're obviously not a Christian then. But there are people among those who profess to love Jesus Christ, those who truly love Jesus Christ, and those who are doing it for other reasons. Self-preservation, self-love, they feel better in the church. There's many different reasons that comes to man's sinful heart why they will remain in the church and not be honest with themselves. But here we're looking at, what did Mother Teresa teach? What did she believe? Does she have a credible profession of faith? Christian News, back in November 11th, 1985, quoted her as saying, "We gather to thank God for the 40 years of the beautiful work of the United Nations for the good of people. No color, no religion, no nationality should come between us. We are all the children. We are all children of God." Now, she was talking that in the context of abortion, things like that. She believed we are all children of God. No, really, it doesn't matter what you believe, according to Mother Teresa. This is back in 1985. And a lot of this, if you studied any bit of Mother Teresa, this is not going to be shocking, I guess. But for, I pray, again, the point of doing this is, there are many people out here, out in the world, that aren't aware of this. You may be in a liberal Protestant church. I have had emails from various liberal Protestant churches, or people in liberal Protestant churches, some looking to get out and join theological Orthodox churches and things like that, that believe that Mother Teresa was wonderful and what she taught in our way, and that she was actually a Christian. And the same thing with other people in the world, but we'll for the sake of today, we'll just leave it at that. So, in April 7th to 13th, 1990, an issue of Radio Times tells a story of Mother Teresa sheltering an old Hindu priest. Quote, she said, this report states, sorry, "She nursed him with her own hands and helped him to die, reconciled with his own gods." Yes, you've heard right. Mother Teresa, rather than trying even to convert people, not to the, no, the, I say the Roman Catholic gospel, because the Roman Catholic gospel is a different gospel. It is a gospel of works. The gospel of grace, according to the Bible and the scriptures, is that those who trust and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ have been saved by faith alone, through grace alone, not of works, lest any man should boast. Go to Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 to 10 to read about that. So, it is a gift of God. It is not, man hates the light, he's spiritually dead. Man is dead in trespasses and sins. Again, Ephesians 2, verse 1. But he's been made alive. He's been quickened. Those who've been made alive, the Bible talks about the quick and the dead. The quick, basically, those who are alive, spiritually alive. But, okay, that's the biblical gospel is all of grace. It is a work God does. And as I quoted earlier in Philippians, chapter 1, verses 5 to 7, it is a work he will perform until the end. Basically, if somebody's regenerated, they're not going to get unregenerated again. They will persevere until the end. Because it is a work of God. Jesus Christ is the author and finisher of our salvation. All those who look unto him with the eye of faith. The Roman Catholic gospel believes people are regenerated by baptism, by physical baptism. The Bible teaches about spiritual baptism. It's called regeneration, but the Roman Catholic Church teaches everybody who's received water baptism has been regenerated, and then they must, through works of merit, and this talks about this in the Catholic Catechism as well, they have to maintain good works, and then they merit salvation for them and for others. those who are in purgatory and such. But so the Roman Catholic Church's gospel does not save. It is a gospel of works. Christ said on the cross, tetelestai, paid in full. The way it's rendered in English is, it is finished, he cried from the cross. Literally, to be paid in full. He paid the debt that was owed by his people for the offenses against a holy and just God. Isaiah 53 verse 10 talks about how the Son bore the wrath of the Father. He satisfied justice on their behalf and made intercession. Jesus Christ made intercession, that's who's spoken about in Isaiah chapter 53, for the transgressors, those who are lawbreakers, sinners, those who will look with the eye of faith unto Christ, unto Christ alone, not to your works. But Mother Teresa wasn't even, who seen, according to Roman Catholic teaching, is to be seen as an example, didn't even convert people to the Roman Catholic Church gospel. Now, even look, the Catholic Catechism, we did this in an early show as well, also recognizes Muslims as being part of the fold as well. How that makes any sense, I do not know. Basically, it doesn't. But if you are a Hindu to Mother Teresa, she just wanted to make you a better Hindu, a better Muslim, a better whatever you were. To quote here, this is in the biography, Mother Teresa, Her People and Her Work. She was quoted by Desmond Doig as follows, quote, she said, if in coming face to face with God, we accept him in our lives, then we are converting. We are becoming a better Hindu, a better Muslim, a better Catholic, a better whatever we are. What approach would I use? For me, naturally, it would be a Catholic one. But for you, it may be Hindu. For someone else, Buddhist, according to one's conscience. What God is in your mind, you must accept. What she's basically teaching, and you look at other quotations from her, she's teaching, well, this way works for me, but you might have another way to be a better Hindu and to use the Hindu gods and all this. She's teaching there are many ways. She taught, she's not alive anymore. She taught that there were many ways to God. And if we believe that Christianity is represented by this, that what Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. That is in John chapter 14, verse 6. That he is the way, not just a way, but the way, the truth, and the life. Did Mother Teresa believe this in her life? No. And she talked about making people a better, whatever they were. And then it says, she said in another part, in an interview with the Associated Press, it's up to you to decide how to worship him. That's back in 1997. So, she didn't see that as a role. Now, that is how she would even depart from Roman Catholic Orthodoxy. I can't remember the guy's name, actually, but a number of years ago, I think it was back in 2008, Chris Arnson of Iron Sharpens Iron Radio put out a show. Really good. It's a really interesting interview, actually. I think Zima was the guy's name, but he's a Roman Catholic scholar, and he wrote a book about Mother Teresa, and back in 2008, Chris Arnson had him on the show. So if you go to Iron Sharpens Iron Radio and maybe do a search in the box in the corner for Mother Teresa, there's a show, they put it up as for old podcasts, and that's a really interesting interview because it's from a Roman Catholic scholar. And the good thing about Chris made it very clear in the show, look, we are not being ecumenical here, we don't agree with each other. And it was quite clear all the way through the interview, it was done really well. But if you want more information on that, that was a really interesting interview showing that even according to Roman Catholic teaching, she still does not line up to be classified as a saint. But more importantly, as I would argue, she never had a credible profession of faith in Jesus Christ. She taught many ways to God. But what else did she teach? And these things that I'm going to bring up now would be more in line with Roman Catholic theology. She talked about the necessity of a priest in her book, Be Holy. I'm just going to quote really briefly on this, but this is from page 109. That she said, quote, only the priest can put Jesus there for us. I'm just going to quote in full, give the full context. I'll read it all because she did believe in transubstantiation, that the priest conjured up Jesus and reenacted a re-crucifixion. This is in line with Roman Catholic theology. It is blasphemous. It is a denial of the sufficiency of the work on Calvary of Jesus Christ. It's saying that Christ didn't pay everything, but that it continues on the altar of the Roman Catholic, of every Roman Catholic Church. She wrote, I remember the time a few years ago when the president of Yemen asked us to send some of our sisters to his country. I told him that this was difficult because for so many years, no chapel was allowed in Yemen for saying a public mass, and no one was allowed to function there publicly as a priest. I explained that I wanted to give them sisters, but the trouble was that without a priest, without Jesus going with them, our sisters couldn't go anywhere. It seems that the president of Yemen had some kind of consolation, and the answer that came back to us was, yes, you can send a priest with the sisters. I was so struck with the thought that only when the priest is there can we have our altar and our tabernacle and our Jesus. Only the priest can put Jesus there for us. And she wrote that in Be Holy, page 109. She talks about devotion to Mary. Mary, and I'll probably get into another show, never accepted worship. And the few times we do see in the Bible Mary mentioned, she tells people to obey her son, John chapter 2. And in Luke chapter 1, the verse is not Hail Mary full of grace, but that she has found grace in the eyes of God. Mary was a sinner. She was not a perpetual virgin. She did not die a virgin. It doesn't make any sense. The scriptures talks about Jesus having brothers and sisters. And then he refers to his true family, spiritual family, or those who follow the will of the Father. Now, we'll probably do that in another show. But what I'm saying to you is this. Let us follow what the scriptures say and not what tradition says. She did not die a virgin. That would be highly unusual, and actually it would be in violation of her marriage vows to withhold herself from her husband. She was married. She was married. She was married to Joseph. Now, just because she didn't die a virgin doesn't mean she even had children. She wouldn't have necessarily had to have children. But it would be incredibly strange, would it not? She would have died a virgin. There's nothing in Christian theology that necessitates the perpetual virginity of Mary. Mary was a sinner, just like anybody's. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. That includes Romans 3:23. That includes Mary. Everybody. The only person is good is God. And that is Jesus Christ. No one else. So she talks about tremendous devotion to Mary. Again, it's idolatry, and it shouldn't happen. We are to go to God and to God alone. Let's look at the first commandment. Let's look at the first commandment, actually, while we're talking about it. Thou shalt have no gods before me. This is Exodus chapter 20, verse 2. Or we verse 2 as well. I am the Lord thy God, which have brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. None. No devotion to anyone else. Now, what else could I talk about? Now, there's one other topic, if there's time in the show, we're going to look at. But we're just going to look a bit more on Rome's view of saints. During the Reformation, there was a counter-Reformation as well, in which the Roman Catholic Church, in a lot of ways, in some ways for the first time, crystallized their opposition, excuse me, to the Bible, to the Gospel of Grace. In the Council of Trent, which was spearheaded often by the Jesuits, took place over many years, put forth many anathemas against the Reformers' gospel, being the gospel of Paul, the gospel of Isaiah, the gospel of Jesus, the gospel represented by the scriptures, being all of grace, and the cry of sola scriptura. In opposition, Rome came back with sola ecclesia, that it was the church that was to interpret. Now, I know there's the three stools, there's the magisterium, there's the papacy, tradition. Well, I suppose the magisterium and papacy are the same, this tradition. How you define that is another thing. You have the papacy, the magisterium, tradition. Yeah, and there's been different views about tradition over the years. It can be the church fathers, or this, as was represented by Trent, kind of a hidden tradition, kind of like almost an esoteric teaching that was given to Jesus and given to nobody else. Talks about that at the start of the Trent. No way to test that out. Talks about tradition and says, and these truths and rules are contained in the written books of the unwritten and in unwritten traditions which received by the apostles from the mouth of Christ himself or from the apostles themselves and the Holy Ghost dictating have come down to us, transmitting as it were from hand to hand. So this kind of unwritten tradition. Now, let's look at Rome's view. This is session 25 of the Council of Trent, and it talks about the to intercession and invocation of the saints, the veneration of relics, the legitimate use of images, teaching them that the saints who reign together with Christ offer up their prayers to God for men, that is good and beneficial, supplementing to invoke them and to have recourse to their prayers, assistance, and support in order to obtain favors from God through his Son, Jesus Christ. So it is good, according to the Council of Trent, and beneficial, supplementing to invoke them. And then it says a little bit later on about the invocation, veneration, and relics of saints, says, those who maintain that veneration and honor are not due to the relics of the saints, or that these and other memorials are honored by the faithful without profit, which is basically the Reformers' view, and that the place is dedicated to the memory of the saints for the purpose of obtaining their aid, are visited in vain, as in these things are of no value, are to be utterly condemned. as the church itself has already have a long since condemned, now and again condemns them. Moreover, the images of Christ or of the Virgin Mary, Virgin Mother of God, or of other saints to be placed and retained, especially in the churches, that due honor and veneration is to be given to them. I'm just going to read that little part again. Talks about images of Christ, again, a violation of the Second Commandment. Pictures, images, again, violation of the Second Commandment. It talks about retaining them in the churches. What for worship? What do you do in the church but worship God? And that due honor and veneration, this whole interesting thing of, no, no, we don't worship Mary, we just venerate her. It's a synonym. That due honor and veneration is to be given to them, worship of them. In Canon 1186, after this, we're going to actually look at, we're going to go back to Mother Teresa again. But I want to look at it. It's a slightly different subject, so I want to cover this first. But Canon 1186 talks about, now the title, now the canon law. This is canon law. This was published back in 1983. There might be newer editions of this. But, so this is canon law 1186. And this, and the section is called, it's title 4, The Cult of the Saints, of Sacred Images and of Relics. Now, when people think of cult, they think of, you know, Jehovah's Witnesses, Unitarians, things like that. Now, the way the Roman Catholic Church is using cult is not in that sense. Now, I know when people say it, they say, oh, see, Rome uses the term the cult of Mary. Ah, it's a cult. The word cult is a very old, going back to Latin, etc., it's a very old understanding. I remember when I was in Italy, and I'm not saying that this makes it right, it's still just as bad, but I just want to make sure people understand it, because it's very easy for straw men to be presented to Roman Catholic apologists, because we've misunderstood something. We should be careful, even if it's wrong, we should present the other side as fairly as possible. We may make mistakes, and we do it often, but we should try and correct it and aim as much as possible, because it's very easy to the other side. It's like, aha, look, they messed up there. Now, what cult, like, I remember when I was living in Italy, I remember I was looking at websites to go to a church to worship, and then it talks about il culto. C-U-L-T-O. In Italian, il culto. They'll say, you know, like, il culto a alle nove. Like, they'll say, basically, worship is at night. So, culto, as it is in Italian, modern-day Italian, is worship. So, they'll say, basically, the, if you were going to put it into modern English, the cult is at 9 o'clock. Now, of course, in English, in modern English, we use it in a completely different way. We refer to, you know, Scientology or something like that. But in the way Roman Catholicism uses it, and with the way it was used in history, it wasn't really used like that. It was used in terms of its etymology, you could say, worship. So another way you could say this is the worship of the saints. Again, this is not me defending it. This is exactly the same way. The cult of Mary is the worship of Mary. Again, in modern day Italian, culto is worship. Canon 1186. To foster the sanctification of the people of God, the church commends to the special and filial veneration of Christ faithful, the blessed Mary, ever virgin, the mother of God, in whom Christ constituted the mother of all. The church also promotes the true and authentic cult of other saints. Read that again. The church also promotes the true and authentic cult, true and authentic worship of other saints, by whose example the faithful are edified and by whose intercession they are supported. So, the intercession supports them. They become this new fountain, derogating again from the Lord Jesus Christ. What have you been told by the Roman Catholic Church in their official teachings is now, well, this even was the case before, but even greater extent now, Mother Teresa was beatified back in, when was it, 19th of October 2003, and now canonized a few days ago, last Sunday, the 4th of September, that according to them, they promote quote-unquote true and quote-unquote authentic worship of Mother Teresa. And they want to see her as an example. Canon 1187, they're the only two canons that really talk about this from what I can see. Only those servants of God may be venerated by public cult, public worship, who have been numbered by ecclesiastical authority among the saints or the blessed. Blessed, beatification, the saints, according to Rome, canonization. That is the signification of it, what it means. I didn't want to cover this show. There was about 10 other shows probably I wanted to cover in its place. But I felt like I needed to talk about this. At least give it an hour or something like that. Regardless of what works Mother Teresa may have done in her life. I don't know. I wasn't beside her. I wasn't working hand in hand with her. I can just go by the quotations and what she has said publicly. And if she believed to her last breath what she professed publicly, she is not in the presence of the Lord right now. Unless, you know, people ask, do you believe Gandhi? Where is Gandhi now? Where's? Be very careful with that question. You know, I remember I read in a book years ago, and somebody asked the typical question, oh, do you believe Gandhi's in hell? Notice how people never ask, you know, do you believe Hitler's in hell? Okay, they recognize Hitler as evil, but they don't recognize we're all evil. We've all broken God's law. We're all fall short of the glory of God. There's none good, no, not one. We've all gone astray. We've all followed many inventions. But they usually talk about Gandhi. And he gives a very good answer. I don't know. It's not that you don't know if he, for example, this is not me giving a Timothy Keller type answer. Like, I don't know where somebody goes. If you're not trusting Christ, if you're not being regenerated, if you're not in Jesus Christ, you are going to hell. Anyone who left this world not trusting in Jesus Christ alone, not the works plus Christ, Jesus Christ alone. Not like the Hindus who just add Christ to everything else. Those who've truly repented of their sin and trust in Jesus Christ. Unless you have done that, unless Christ, the Spirit of God has done a regenerating work in your heart, then you are leaving this earth and going to hell for all eternity. So let me be clear on that. But when somebody asks about a specific person, where is this person? Now, if Mother Teresa believed what she believed onto eternity and never, ever repented and trusted in the true Jesus Christ, then she is in hell today. But I still say, I don't know. Maybe, and I pray that this is the case, maybe, as I read in that book about Gandhi, the book wasn't about Gandhi, by the way, but he said in the book, you know, when people ask him about where's Gandhi now, I said, I don't know. Maybe, maybe he had a Bible, maybe 20 minutes before he died, he repented and trusted in Christ. Maybe there's going to be some people, just like the thief in the cross, who repented at the very, very end. You know, that there was a thief in the cross at the sight of Christ. This man, got the death sentence. He was not a good man. What was the difference between the two thieves on either side? One repented. One recognized Jesus as Lord and Savior. And he said, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Notice how he never said, pray this prayer after me. He trusted in Christ from his heart. So, when people ask about individual people, don't get drawn into that. The issue is, are they trusting in Jesus Christ alone? Did Mother Teresa, from what we know in a written record, trust in Christ? No, she did not. She taught many paths to God. She taught veneration to Mary. She taught that the priest brings Christ with him. And without that, there's no Christ. So basically, the priest has got sovereign control over Jesus Christ. That's not the Jesus Christ of the Bible. That's not the God of the Bible. That's not even the Mary of the Bible. So I always say to people, don't kind of come up with YouTube videos saying Mother Teresa is in hell right now. Again, maybe, you know, you can have deathbed conversion stories, all this kind of stuff. Do you know what? There's going to be some people, I'm not saying how many there's going to be, that will just surprise us and go, really? You repented? In heaven? There's going to be some people we're going to be surprised about. We never knew they repented. Again, the thief in the cross. Unless that was recorded, who would have known about it? So, I'm not saying that we kind of go down this, I say the Timothy Keller answer, because he gave a very weak answer one time to, oh, I can't remember the presenter's name, I think it's from CNN. But anyway, I don't want to kind of give a, I don't know. If you don't trust in Christ, you have no hope, your greatest deeds are but filthy rags, you will bear the wrath of God yourself for all eternity. Because you can never pay for your crimes in any length of time. Your crimes are infinite against an infinite God, so you will spend an eternity in hell. And if Mother Teresa believed what she is stated to believing into eternity, she's in hell right now. But when we get drawn on individual people, and maybe we don't know about the end of their life. We pray that they got saved maybe at that point, but we just don't know. We just leave it alone. We don't have to have answers to everything that isn't answered. But again, let me be very, very clear. The only hope to enter into heaven is through Jesus Christ. If you're outside of Jesus Christ, entering into eternity, you will spend an eternity in hell because you will pay for your sins. Now, there was also a bit of talk about some depression in Mother Teresa's life. And I want to comment on this video by a Jesuit. It's a Jesuit publication. Get in front of me here. And on it, this is a Jesuit priest, James Martin, and he talks about Teresa of Calcutta. So, but there was a talk about how she felt abandoned by God. That there was this darkness around her. The answer is given as strange, and it just shows this talking out both sides of the mouth. I play this for one reason and one reason only. She is held up as an example for the church. According to Roman Catholic teaching, she is supposed to be an example and someone to intercede, according to Roman Catholicism, not according to Scripture. According to Scripture, she has no recorded, credible profession of faith that she was ever a saint trusting in Jesus Christ. This is James Martin on Teresa of Calcutta.
Saint Teresa of Calcutta may be the most beloved of modern saints. During her long life, Mother Teresa was revered as a living saint, as she served the poorest of the poor around the world. As a result, most people, even those who knew her well, assumed that she had a rich and satisfying prayer life. But not long after her death, the world discovered something shocking. She had a rich world. As a result,
I just want to give people, you know, if anybody's listening to this on Megiddo Radio, through the MegiddoRadio.com website, the man speaking is James Martin, editor-at-large of America Media, which is a Jesuit publication.
Most people, even those who knew her well, assumed that she had a rich and satisfying prayer life. But not long after her death, the world discovered something shocking. For the last 50 or so years of her life, Mother Teresa felt a profound sense of distance from God. That is, she didn't feel the presence of God in her interior life. It was a source of great suffering and confusion for her. At one point, she wrote to one of her confessors, quote, "In my soul, I feel that terrible pain of loss, of God not wanting me, of God not being God, of God not existing," end quote.
Isn't that amazing? I feel like God doesn't exist. Now, true believers in Jesus Christ can have moments of doubt, can have times where they're like, you just doubt God. It is sinful, by the way. Unbelief is sinful. The issue is not God. The issue is within our hearts. We know from creation, this talks about this in Romans chapter 1, that we are without excuse. So, well, all of us struggle with unbelief at times. But you'd have to really wonder about somebody who's going through severe depression. I'm talking about severe depression now. I'm not talking about moments of depression or times when we feel down. I mean, there's people like Charles Spurgeon had various periods in his life where he didn't feel great and things like that. But to kind of get to a point, and you might have periods in your time where you feel like God has abandoned you. Like David talks about in various parts of the Psalms. But does that continue throughout their entire life? No. They realize God is merciful. God chastises. See, that is unbelief. There's times when God will not answer straight away, because to test us to see so that we will trust him. The long and the short of it is, when we get to moments like that, the problem is not God. The problem is us. Is we're looking to ourselves. And Mother Teresa in her early life, she developed and trusted in kind of mystical experiences where she felt called to work with the poor and things like that. And I suppose they dried up. In biblical Christianity, we can never go on our emotions. Yes, emotions are important, but they go hand in hand with the facts. For example, like the fact that if I can say there's things I love about my wife. You know, I love her smile and things like that. And when I see her smiling, I attribute happiness to that. Or not attributed, but you know, I'm happy. So that's why I can't kind of go, I'm looking for happiness. It can't be, one has to come from factual basis. We have to love things about God. But she didn't really trust God. This, when we go through, yes, we're all sinful, and yes, we go through things like this, but when we go through things like this, when the joy of the Lord has been taken from us, this is what David talks about. David talks about in Psalm 51. Let's go there really fast. And this is after he commits adultery. And what does he cry out? Psalm 51. He says, In verse 12, restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and hold me with thy free spirit. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation. He realizes how sinful he is, but the joy of the Lord is to be our strength, as in, we are joyful in the Lord. This is, regardless of what's going on around us, like the apostles were persecuted and things like that, but they had that joy. They were singing in prison, all this kind of thing, because they trusted in him and they were rejoicing in his salvation. And regardless of what man did to them, they had that joy and that peace that passed all understanding. Did Mother Teresa have that? No, she didn't. And this Jesuit priest is trying to explain why this is true, and she's still a quote-unquote saint in the eyes of the Catholic Church.
How could this be? Well, spiritual writers have long talked about the dark night of the soul, a time of extended emptiness in prayer. Yet no saint, as far as I know, experienced this for so long. Earlier in her life, Mother Teresa had a series of mystical experiences that convinced her that Jesus was calling her to work with the poor. And that kind of satisfying prayer continued for several years during the period that she was founding her religious order, the Missionaries of Charity. Then, nothing. Her prayer life dried up. Recently, I asked the official promoter of her cause, Father Brian Koladejchuk, if he felt that this dryness continued for the rest of her life, to her death. He was very blunt. Yes, he said. In time, with the help of her spiritual director, Mother Teresa came to see this dark night as a further invitation to union with Jesus Christ, who felt abandoned on the cross himself, and with the poor, who feel abandoned every...
Sorry, just think about this. This is what her spiritual director told her. Oh, yeah, you see, you don't believe God. You're having this same depression. You feel like God's abandoned you. Use this to come closer to God, the God who you don't trust. On the cross, when Christ cried out, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? It was because God poured out the wrath those who were in Christ deserved upon him, upon that tree. He bore the wrath of God. And yes, he was abandoned because he who knew no sin became sin for us. This is a unique thing that we cannot... The difference is, in Christ's case, it was true. But Christ never said, I don't believe that God exists. Whatever you believe, what Mother Teresa was going through was a severe state of unbelief, which many people on the fringes of the church deal with, and the true church I'm talking about now, and maybe even fade away. Maybe because they've never been born again. And when they do not know and do not have that peace, you have to wonder. We can't proclaim this person's saved, this person's lost, and all this kind of stuff. We can only go by credible professions of faith. Are they trusting on the Lord Jesus Christ, and are they following him? That's the fruit. One's the root. One's the fruit. The fruit is obedience.
Every day. This helped Mother Teresa find meaning in this darkness, in this dark night. Let me suggest three spiritual lessons to draw from her experience. First, we tend to think that the saints had it easier than we do. We think, well, they have all these gifts that I don't have, so I'll leave the radical Christianity to them. But as Mother Teresa shows us, many of the saints had it harder than we do. It's a reminder not to let ourselves...
Many people like Jeremiah and those times when even Elijah was depressed. But, and Jonah and people like that. but they were being sinful. They were like, I don't want to do this anymore. This is too much. But as Jeremiah put it, it was a burning in his bosom. He felt he had to. He was given this burden to preach the gospel. That's in those circumstances. All of these people in the scriptures were sinful creatures. It talks about that battle between the flesh, the spirit and the flesh in Romans chapter 7. But we can't just say, oh, well, they had it tough. We're talking about in the inside. Okay, she had it tough in a kind of a temporal sense. She was working with the poor and things like that in Calcutta. How would I put this? This is not somebody to take an example from, because what she's displaying is unbelief. What she displayed, sorry, is unbelief. So there's no, oh, she's a saint still, even though she doesn't have a credible profession of faith. But she's still an example. We just have to explain around it, which is what the Jesuits are known for in their sophistry and their casuistry.
Off the spiritual hook so easily, and that we are all called to sanctity. Second, Mother Teresa relied on her earlier experiences in prayer to sustain her, those mystical experiences. She never doubted that original call. Thus, the rest of her life can be seen as a radical act of fidelity. It's an example to all of us who have made a commitment, but who may struggle with it. Mother Teresa says, you can do it. Third, Mother Teresa can now be seen as the patron saint of doubters, or as she put it, a saint of the darkness. What an irony. The woman who many people thought had it made in the spiritual life becomes the one that we can look to in our doubts. For all those who struggle with their faith, you now have another role model and advocate in heaven, a faithful woman who struggled with her faith.
So she's the patron saint of doubters, quoting him here. And she's faithful, a faithful doubter. I'm sorry, but the opposite of trusting is, if my wife tells me something and I doubt her, well, I don't trust her. I don't have faith in her, what she said. So how is that an example? Again, can you just pick and no, with venerated, worshipped saints, canonized saints, they are held up as examples to be and to receive authentic, quote unquote, authentic cult, authentic worship, according to canon law. Such an explanation is where language just falls apart. Venerate no longer means venerate. Cult no longer means cult. Doubting no longer means unbelief. So she believed in her early experiences, but she just remained the rest of her life in doubt, at least according to this Jesuit priest. How is this an example to follow? How is she faithful then? Basically, you have to boil it down to the works matter. It doesn't matter what you believe. Now, he's not saying that, but that's the only conclusion you can come to that makes what he says, that would make what he said make sense. Because if she was doubting God was with her, if she was doubting him, then it's not faith, is it?
While at the same time loving and serving the God whom she sought in utter darkness.
How can you serve a God who believed that doesn't even exist? Like, she clearly did not feel that he was with her. You can't. Oh, man. It's a complete contradiction. Again, you have to say that what you believe in your head and heart doesn't matter. And all that matters is the works that you do. And as long as you serve Mother Church.
Saint Teresa of Calcutta, pray for us.
So that is from America Media, which is a Jesuit ministry. Okay, so we're going to leave it there. I pray by the grace of God that that has been presented okay. I pray that if you're a Roman Catholic and you've gotten to the end of the show, I thank you. Thank you for listening this far. I pray that, look, search the scriptures. Compare everything with scripture. I pray that you will see how scripture is sufficient. We are not to look to authorities outside of the Word of God. Yes, there are human authorities to which the Bible delegates responsibility, like pastors or elders, they're synonymous. But everything is to be subordinate, even the confessions that we believe and things like that, subordinate and tested by and compared with the Word of God, because this is the infallible standard. Mother Teresa is not an infallible standard. Pope Francis is not an infallible standard. These are sinners who've fallen short of the glory of God, as I have. Look, here's the thing. I am not an infallible standard either. The Word of God is the infallible standard. Test all things against the Word of God. And I pray that you will trust and put your faith in the author and finisher of true biblical salvation, Jesus Christ. This has been Paul Flynn. May God bless you all.